Good morning. I'm Jerry Rubino, welcoming you to the 28th week of our virtual online streaming of our morning worship service here from Spirit of Hope United Methodist Church in Golden Valley, Minnesota. I know I said good morning. You might not be watching it in the morning when you get to it, but we are hopeful that you are excited and ready and willing and engaged to participate with us in our worship service. Welcome, and think about the lyrics to the prelude I'm going to play today. It's a wonderful hymn, Just a Closer Walk with Thee. I held the cord until you took your mask off.
Very nice.
Thank you.
And how appropriate. In days where we are scattered and pulled apart, the invitation to walk close to Jesus, to walk close to one another. It's a good way to start this morning. Welcome to Spirit of Hope United Methodist Church. If you are part of the church, we're glad you're here. If you're checking in, stay with us. We're going to have a good worship service this morning, and we're going to begin right now with some singing.
Donna Beyer is here, leading us along with Paul David on the microphone. I just welcome you again, as always, to use these words as part of your worship time with our God. All three of these songs are thoughtful love songs. This first one is Great Descriptor. Must be a favorite of mine. We just did it a few weeks ago. We'll do it again. And
Jesus, name above all names, beautiful Savior, glorious Lord.
Try to get some inspiration from the lectionary as we choose our music for each Sunday. And in the lectionary is this upcoming text: He is Lord, He is Lord, He is risen from the dead, He is Lord. It comes from Philippians chapter 2. If you don't know it, learn it with us.
He is Lord, He is Lord, He is risen.
This is our praise song.
Son of God, this is our praise song. Jesus, my Lord, I sing to you. Come now, Spirit.
We love you again.
We love you. We love you. We love you. We worship you.
Together.
Please join me in the responsive reading you'll find in your bulletin. We begin this virtual gathering with a song of praise to the one we call Jesus, who is the way to and into a life that is itself raised up, filled with grace and hope, and resounding with joy always. Thank God. Amen.
rejoice, give thanks, and sing. Your sovereign God adore. For Christ has robbed us sting and triumphs evermore. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say rejoice. Our Savior Jesus reigns, the God of truth and love. The Lamb who purged our stains is crowned with power above. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say rejoice. Christ Jesus cannot fail to use both earth and heaven. The keys of death and hell are to the Savior give. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say rejoice. Rejoice in glorious hope, for Christ the judge shall come and take the faithful up to their eternal home. We soon will hear a heavenly voice above the trumpet sound.
Please join with me in the responsive prayer. Rejoice, give thanks, and sing. What a good idea. Before we talk about the weather, before we bemoan the state of the world and argue politics, before we pull out our list of things we want you to do for us, God, let us rejoice, give thanks, and sing. Lift up our hearts, our voices in joy. Rejoice again and again, not because everything is so wonderful, but because we are yours. And we get that, thankfully. That might just change all that other stuff. Or maybe it'll just change us in Christ. So may it be. Amen.
May God's peace be with you.
And also with you.
I thank you. You are invited to share that gift of peace with those you might be sitting near, with people online, your fellow parishioners, people you might want to greet. It's nice when you do that, you check in, we know you're there, and we can't see you from here. You can see us, but it's always nice to know that there's more than just those of us in the room who are participating in the service today. It's good to be with you. Two announcements, I think. Those are the only ones I've come up with so far. The sort of the standard one, Bible study on Tuesday morning, 10 o'clock. It's a Zoom Bible study, and last Tuesday we all got in. I went to the right room, opened the door, and everybody got there, and it was fine. It was fun. We had a good time. And as I said last Sunday, you don't have to have knowledge of the text or the Bible. You don't even have to have read it beforehand. You're just invited to come and join in, and maybe you have a question, maybe you have observation, maybe you have experience, maybe you just want to be quiet. That's all just fine. We do have a good time. And sometimes we even learn something from one another, which is gravy, I guess. Spirit of Hops is gathering this afternoon at 5-ish at Heath and Alyssa Brown's, correct? Yeah. Yes. So you're invited. Welcome to bring your own beverage. We'll be outside, so dress appropriately, and we'll spend some time together. We have one other announcement, an invitation, I think. Yes? Yeah. Come on up.
Hi, I'm Hani, and I'm selling popcorn to support my Cub Scout pack. My mom is going to post a link in the comments if you want to order online, or you can contact my mom or dad for more info. Thanks for your support.
Thanks for the continuing sending in the pictures, and we are posting them.
Thank you. Yes. Jerry reminded me, and I need reminding, if you look around, as the cameras look around, you'll see there are some more photos of people that have been sent in, and we think we have you in your regular place. Yes. And wonderful photographs, and we're kind of beginning to fill the place, and it feels more populated, and that's great. So continue to do that. Send in a picture of yourself, you and your family, you and your dog, your cat, whatever, they can come too. It's just fine. We are radically inclusive. As you can see, we have Al Franken with us here this morning. I don't know that he's a regular attender, but we're glad to have him. All right. I have a children's time, don't I?
Yeah.
I do, yes. You're walking up here, you threw me off just a little bit, and it's just fine.
I have that effect on you.
You do. Yes.
This is where children belong, welcomed as part of the worshiping throng. Water, God's word, bread and cup, prayer and song. This is where children belong.
Thank you. That was what was going on. I get concerned when people come up on either side of me. I don't know what that says. We don't have a story to read today because the section of the scripture that we were going to read today was in last Sunday's story. But you may remember we've been journeying with the Hebrew people. They were slaves in Egypt. They had a difficult time getting out. They got out. They're in the wilderness. They're hungry. They're complaining about being hungry, griping at Moses for not providing enough food. And today, they're complaining about they don't have water to drink. You know, people just want everything. They want food, they want water, and it's just, they're very demanding people. But one of the things that they do is learn along the way a variety of things, as we do, as we are learning. And the questions in the bulletin or in the order are, the Hebrew people learn in the wilderness to trust God, at least some of them do. What does it take to trust somebody? In this wandering time, our time during this pandemic, who and what do we trust? There's a question there that isn't supposed to be there, so I'm just going to let that one go for now. The other question was, do you have particular people that you trust and look to? And who might those be? And you can talk about that. One of the trust issues that I've talked about in our household has to do with Otis, the rescue wonder dog, the dog from Kentucky who continues to learn and continues to teach us. And I've talked before about him and his issues with our son, Noah. Noah is back living with us at least part of the time now. And Noah's in and out, and he comes in with energy, and he paces around. He's on his phone, and he's moving all over the place. And Otis sticks to him like glue, and he'll nip at him and try to catch him as he's going out or as he's going down the basement. And Noah says it's not because he thinks it's not pack behavior or anything like that. I question that. But we had a little breakthrough. Now, I think what's going on is Otis doesn't trust Noah because he's not there all the time, and he wasn't there when Otis arrived. So they didn't form that bond immediately, and Noah wasn't there to welcome him. So there's an issue of a lack of trust. But on, what day was it? Friday. Yes, I think it was Friday. Thursday or Friday, Noah and I were talking in the living room, and Otis is there with his chew toy that he's sort of almost shredded, and it's a tug-of-war toy. And he grabbed it and came over to Noah and held it up for Noah to take hold of. And he did. And we had a little bit of gentle tug-of-war back and forth. And then Noah let go, and Otis took it and then came back and offered it to him again. So we had two rounds of this tug of war, and I could see Otis is trying to, can I trust this guy? And Noah, there was this delight in him that there's maybe a bond forming. Now, Otis didn't give up his behavior yet, his guard dog behavior, but we might be moving to another place with these two, and I have my fingers crossed. I'm hopeful now that there is some trust developing. It's not easy. Trust is a hard thing to develop, and trust and faith are the same thing. Our trust in God doesn't come easily or automatically. I think we learn that, and we see it in other people and learn that from other people, and we continue to work at that in this time where we don't know where we're going to land or how things are going to be. We trust that God is with us and leading us in the way that we need to go. So let's pray. Gracious one, generous one, kind, faithful one, we know you are with us, or at least we believe that is so. We trust that is so. And we work on that deepening trust, so that when we can't find our way or unsure, we look to you, we lean on you, and we travel together in the context of your gracious goodness and promise. Help us to do that today and tomorrow and in all the days to come, and to help each other along the way. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our first reading this morning comes from the book of Exodus, chapter 17, verses 1 through 7. From the wilderness of Sin, the whole congregation of the Israelites journeyed by stages, as the Lord commanded. They camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink. The people quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." Moses said to them, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you test the Lord?" But the people thirsted there for water. And the people complained against Moses and said, "Why did you bring us out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our livestock with thirst?" So Moses cried out to the Lord, "What shall I do with these people? They're almost ready to stone me." The Lord said to Moses, "Go on ahead of the people and take some of the elders of Israel with you. Take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile and go. I will be standing there in front of you on the rock at Horeb. Strike the rock, and water will come out of it, so the people may drink." Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. He called the place Massah and Meribah, because the Israelites quarreled and tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?"
The gospel reading is from the 21st chapter of the Gospel of Matthew, beginning with verse 23. When he entered the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him as he was teaching and said, "By what authority are you doing these things, and who gave you this authority?" Jesus said to them, "I will also ask you one question. If you tell me the answer, then I will also tell you by what authority I do these things. Did the baptism of John come from heaven, or was it of human origin?" And they argued with one another. "If we say from heaven, he will say to us, 'Why then did you not believe him?' But if we say of human origin, we are afraid of the crowd, for all regard John as a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We do not know." And he said to them, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things then. What do you think? A man had two sons. He went to the first and said, 'Son, go and work in the vineyard today.' He answered, 'I will not.' But later he changed his mind and went. The father went to the second and said the same, and he answered, 'I go, sir,' but he didn't go. Which of the two did the will of his father?" They said, "The first." Jesus said to them, "Truly I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are going into the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him. And even after you saw it, you did not change your minds and believe him. For the word of God in Scripture, within us, among us, and beyond us, thanks be to God." If it's calm enough in the evening or the wind is in the right direction, I can sometimes hear the 9 o'clock siren that sounds from downtown Robbinsdale, and we live a couple miles away. And every time I hear that, it takes me back, because where I grew up, we heard a siren just like that. We called it the whistle. We heard that 3 times a day. It sounded at noon to call you home for dinner. We call it dinner. We call it lunch. It sounded at 6 o'clock in the evening to call you home for supper. And then it sounded again the last time at 9 o'clock to call you home for the day, for the night. It was always a call to come home every time we heard it. Do you hear it now? Because it is sounding, in a way, the call to come home. It is what Jesus did. It is what he said. It is who he was. It is who he is. And the church, I think, is called to embody that call, that invitation. Now, in the text today, Jesus has just arrived. He's about 24 hours earlier in town, in Jerusalem. And in that time, he's already stirred up trouble. The Romans are in town. It's Passover. It's a holiday. So all kinds of people come in for this holiday. And the Romans come with extra crowd control. So they have police in riot gear with tear gas, and they have National Guard with tanks, and they are prepared for trouble, looking for it, watching for it, waiting for it. They're not going to put up with it. So they come in with this tremendous show of power, of force, and they come in from the west. Jesus comes in from the east, riding a donkey, surrounded by children and poor people. He intentionally mocks the Romans with this riding in. He echoes a call, or lifts up a call, from one of the prophets who says, "Behold, your king coming to you riding on a donkey." He evokes that. And he symbolically reclaims the city for God as he rides in. He does a similar thing when, just a little while later, he comes into the temple. And he kicks over the tables of the money changers, who charge about 50% fee on all of their services, so they profit big time, and you have to change your money to participate in the temple goings-on. He chases out those who are selling the doves, the sacrificial animals that the poor maybe can afford, even though there's a huge markup on them as well. So there's all kinds of money being made. Jesus does not approve. And echoing both the prophet Isaiah and the prophet Jeremiah, he says, this is supposed to be a house of prayer for all people. You turn it into a den of thieves and robbers. Religion as business, as commerce, is a problem. Buying and selling, the exorbitant profits that are made, the fees that are charged, they make the temple a dividing rather than a unifying place. God's people have to pay to play. You have to have money to get in and to participate in what's going on there. It's the commodification of God. And God has become too expensive for some people. Jesus' demonstration is exactly that. It's a political protest against what's going on, and it is not nonviolent, and it's good for us to be aware of that. You may have heard on, Thursday, the Westminster Town Hall Forum was carried on public radio. It was a virtual forum. They usually meet at the church, Westminster Presbyterian Church in Minneapolis. Dr. Victoria Sweet was the speaker, and she was interviewed by Kathy Werzer. And the topic was slow medicine. She has a book called Slow Medicine. She also has one called God's Hotel. I haven't read either, but they're on my list. She's talking about slow medicine as compared to sort of the way that medicine is often practiced now in this country. It's scheduled, and you have just so much time, and you got to move on, and maybe you go into the hospital, and you have some operation, and you're out as quickly as we can get you out. And she says that that's based sort of on the metaphor of body as machine. It's made up of various parts, and if there's a part that's not functioning, maybe you can clean it up, maybe you can replace it. There are things that are connected, but it's a connection of replaceable parts. It's not necessarily a whole or treated as a whole. She said the metaphor of body as plant is essential as well. They go together. We need them both. But the body as one single organism that's all interconnected and interrelated. And so what medicine can do best is to remove whatever obstacles there are for the body to heal itself, because as an organism, the body wants to be whole and well, and it has this inner power, this ability, this desire to heal, to move itself towards wholeness. So if medicine can get the tumor out of the way or open up the passageways for blood to flow, those sorts of things, that's wonderful. Then what's needed is the time and the place for the ongoing healing to occur, because it doesn't happen immediately. She said conditions need to be right for healing to occur. So if you come into the hospital and have a procedure and go out into a lousy situation, chances of your getting well are not very good. If you come into a place where you have good food and care and space and sunshine and quiet, then your chances of healing are much better. She talked about the factors that work against healing. And one of the things that she said just clanged in my ear, she talked about the power of fear to undermine the body's ability to maintain health. To undermine its immune response or its power to heal itself after injury. Fear is a great impediment, and chronic fear, she said, is deadly. And I've been thinking about that ever since, chronic fear. And how many people would you say in our country or in the world right now live with some sort of constant chronic fear? At least of one thing. And I can think of a list of things that people are afraid of losing their home, of losing a job, of losing health insurance, of not being able to pay their bills, not being able to feed their family, losing their place in the world. There's fear regarding the election coming up. And when you hear people talk, the campaigns sometimes, they crank up the fear element to try to motivate you one way or another. And I challenge you to look and listen for that. Who is trying to scare you with what they say? And what response do you have to that? What's going on inside you when you hear that? I just found that fascinating and something I continue to reflect on. But Dr. Sweet's critique of the, what did she call it, the healthcare industry, we call it an industry, rather than the art and science of medicine, her critique is probably not so well received in some circles. Just as Jesus' activity in the temple was not well received by the people in charge there. It's like he kicked the hornet's nest. So the day after this symbolic cleansing or symbolic destruction of the temple as it's functioning, the authorities show up. Jesus is there teaching. He has the gall to come back. And they confront him and they say, who do you think you are doing what you're doing here? You march into town, you ride into town and act like you own the place. Where do you get off coming into our city, into our temple, creating this kind of furor? Who gave you the right? Where does your authority come from to do this? Because he's not ordained clergy. He's not part of the in crowd. He doesn't have credentials. And the word authority, the Greek word, it's exousia. Exousia. And it sounds and speaks of an inner power that expresses itself outwardly. It comes through. Exousia. Your inner force expressing itself, your inner energy, your inner power expressing itself with authority. Where do you get your authority? They ask him. And Jesus responds, well, I'll tell you what. If you can answer my question, I'll answer yours. That's fair enough, isn't it? Oh, sure, they say. Because, well, he's some outstate rube. He doesn't know anything. He's not educated like we are. We're the scholars. We're the folks in charge. And there's all of us here. What can he ask us that we can't answer satisfactorily? So, sure, go ahead. And so he asks him, so John did this baptism in the Jordan, which was a baptism of repentance, the invitation for people to change their lives and re-engage with God. Was that his idea or God's? Was that his authority or did God authorize that? Yikes. They didn't see that coming. That's the classic dilemma. And it's laid out there in the text. They have words with each other. Literally, they have words with each other over this. If we say God authorized this, then he's going to ask us, why didn't you support it? Why didn't you get behind him? Why is he dead now? If we say, well, that was John's thing, then the crowd might haul us out and beat us to death because they believe he's a prophet, maybe even the Messiah, and now he's a martyr, he's a hero. We don't dare. So the response is, we don't know. We don't know. And Jesus says, well, then you don't need to know more from me. But he might have said exactly, you don't know. You do not know the answer to the question. You do not know the damage you are doing with your authority, so-called, the way you express it. There was an article, a story in the Star Trib on Tuesday's paper this week. First section, and the story, the title is Bomb Experts Die Detonating Bomb. Okay, well, yeah, if you detonate a bomb, probably, unless you do it, they're experts. Anyway, that caught my eye. Just the title. But the place that it happened, it was in the Solomon Islands. And anytime I see that, I perk up because my dad was in the Solomon Islands during World War II. He was on Guadalcanal and New Caledonia and several other places. And so I always pay attention when I see that. And the story was about these experts who have spent their careers tracking down, mapping where there are unexploded ordnance left over from war, especially World War II. And so they're found in Europe. They're found in Asia, Southeast Asia, still from the Vietnam War as well, and in the South Pacific. And he said the Solomon Islands are littered with, their sandy soil is littered with these bombs, these shells, these things that didn't go off when they were launched during World War II. They just burrow into the soil, and then they just wait there. They sit there. During the time since the end of the war, the estimate is that scores of people have been killed or maimed when they have hit these bombs with a hoe or a shovel or driven over them. They're just all over the place. And they said that in the Solomons, it is an especially dangerous situation, precarious, because 75% of the population do agricultural labor. So they're out in the fields, they're out digging in the land all the time. And it just, the picture became clearer. And then, besides the sad fact that these men who had given their lives to this task now gave their lives for it, was an observation by this John Rodsted of an organization called Safe Ground that does this work all over the world. He said, referring to the farm workers of the Solomons, he said, they are scared of their own land. They are scared of their own land. They literally live in and on fear, chronic fear. What must that be like? What does that do to them? Well, in a way, is that not what the Jewish authorities, collaborating with the Romans, are doing themselves? As they work together, they make the sacred Holy Land, the city of Jerusalem, the temple itself, that are supposed to be hospitable to the people of Israel, less and less hospitable, less and less welcoming. The people of Jesus, who are supposed to be at home in this place, are not safe there. They're not welcome there. And they are more and more marginalized as more and more people lose their place, lose their land, are on the edge of losing their own existence. They live a fearful existence. And at the same time, the officials, fostering that, live with the illusion that what they're doing is right. This is the right thing. This is the way we live out the way of God. So Jesus comes to dispel that illusion that they live with, to try to confront them with the truth, to, if you will, disillusion them, to be the siren call for them to come home to this deeper, truer, fuller way of being. And that's what the parable that he tells is meant to do, to confront them with their own empty words. They say one thing and do another, and there is not integrity. It doesn't come together. It's empty. He says, it's time to come home. It's time to come home. How do they do that? How do we do that? Well, I think the answer is hinted at in the question about Jesus' authority. Where do you get this authority, this exousia, this power? Where does that come from? A very brief story to end with. I try to start every day with prayer, 20 to 30 minutes of prayer, and not with a list of, okay, God, I need this, I need this, I need you to look after them, I need you to do this. It's prayer in terms of simply being present, being available to God. So I find a place, and it's usually the same place. I have several places in the house that I sit down and get quiet. I may have a cup of tea, I may not. and I simply try to be. And thoughts come, I try to let the thoughts come and go, not chase them, not latch onto them, not wrestle with them, just let them be. Whatever passes through, to simply settle in and down and pay attention to my own breathing and try to listen more deeply than I normally do and be present to the one who is always present. And generally, I do it pretty poorly because I'm very distracted and there's all kinds of things going. It's not about judging that. It's not a performance. It's a practice. So I will never probably get it or perfect it, and that's not the goal. It's just a way of being. Well, a week ago, Monday, and I wrote this in the journal, I was particularly low when I got up in the morning, just feeling disconnected and sad and alone and lonely and just blah, and wondering, does this make any difference? What we're doing, what I'm doing, what difference does it make? What good does it do? And feeling just really out of sorts and out of sync. But the practice is the practice. So I find my place and I sit down to try to quiet and listen. And as I settle down and settle in, it is as if someone speaks into my ear. Now, this has happened to me one other time in my life, so this is not a regular occurrence. But what I heard was, you are all. You are all. And I took that not as aimed at me, but as given to me, as an affirmation. To speak of the one who is all, to be reminded of the one in whom all things belong, in whom all things hold together, the one who surrounds and pervades and is beyond all and within all. You are all. The illusion, I think, that we often live with, that I often live with, is that I'm living my own life, and Jerry, you're living yours, and Donna, you're living yours, and we're sort of together, but we're not together, we're separate, and if I screw up, that's my problem, and maybe if somebody gets something that I want, then I lose out, and so there's competition. The illusion is that we live in disconnection, that we are separate from, that there is brokenness, and that we're all these pieces out there. But what I heard was, you are all, God is all. And all of it, every one of us, and every piece and part, the good and the bad, the broken and the whole, the beautiful and the ugly, the glorious and the horrendous, it is all held in God. It all belongs, it is all gathered in, and it is all called home into the center of this one who is all, to be transformed and redeemed and made whole. That is what this is about, I think. So Jesus says to the authorities, sorry guys, you don't get it, but it's okay. Because the tax collectors and the prostitutes and the other people that you don't have anything to do with, that you think stink, that you think should stay out of the way, those marginalized people, they do get it. And they are leading the way into the kingdom of God. They are leading the way into the realm of the eternal. They're leading the way. And they will show you the way home. They will lead you home. You see, because they need it, and they know it, and they admit it, and they hear the invitation, and they take it to heart. It's time to come home. It's time to come home. In Christ. Amen. So we will take a few moments for prayer. This is a wordy prayer. It tends to be the way we do it in church. It's not the only way to pray. You can send in your prayer requests. I'm guessing some of you
have already, and I heard from a couple people yesterday. So let us bow in prayer. So it is homecoming season, always. We pause to acknowledge that and to allow for it to happen, to be. You are all God. In you we live and move and have our being, though often unaware. But occasionally awakening to your call, your presence, your deeply loving hospitality, and the peace that comes to us when we receive that and let ourselves be immersed and held in that in you. May that happen in us in these moments now and repeatedly in the challenging days ahead. Let that be, not only for us, but for all our siblings who struggle and seek to live your way and your will and your word into being in this world, and there are many. Let it be so that together with them and with all, we can show our beat up, divided, exploited, yet blessed world the way to healing and wholeness. We pray for those gifts to come home and to do their work within all who hunger for them and need them. Amy in her treatment for cancer. John, Susan and Tom Williams, Tom having been tested positive for COVID. That's why they are not here with us today. We hold them in prayer. From Marianne, a prayer of joy for the continuing recovery of Denise, who's had a long siege from a debilitating medical condition. She is walking, and the hope is that she'll be able to go home the end of October. Long time, a long haul. From Mary Youngren, prayers for John in Chicago, a relative who was hospitalized with a severe infection due to complications from surgery in February. Prayers for healing and for doctor's wisdom and insight and listening to diagnose accurately and to treat. From Connie Thompson, prayers for Heath's sister, Carol Lee. She is struggling emotionally and financially, and she is not alone. Blessings from Bernie. Watched the confirmation of their niece Haley and nephew Seth on Facebook this morning. A great outdoor service. And we're grateful for that.
Thank you, PD.
We lift up those who are living with the distress and fear of fire and flood, storm and loss, hunger, homelessness, addiction, and the alienation that is so common and so destructive in this world and time. Amidst these things, yet we give thanks for our belonging, for our being gathered together, for our being called. You are all God, and we are meant to be in you and to become whole and connected and at peace in you and with one another. We welcome that. You call us home together in Christ. So may it be. Amen. As we do every Sunday, we invite your generous spirit to be set free, to do its work, to give and to participate and to reach out in all the ways that you can. Obviously, financial support is something we need and greatly appreciate. And again, a word of thanks for the wonderful support and financial participation from members of this congregation and the larger community. And to remind you that there are all kinds of agencies that are at work in our world, and they are part of God's work as well. So it all belongs. And the healing that is needed and the healing going on is great. And we can be participants in it in all kinds of ways. So let that happen. Having said that, I invite you to join me as we offer thanks. Let us pray. Good God, when we say we are your people, we are not claiming special status. We are acknowledging that we are to live in grace and generosity, with respect for all, always seeking that deeper, richer life and place that we are already given to share. Thank you. Keep calling us home in the way and name and spirit of Jesus, who joins us as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our closing hymn is a classic, O God, our help in ages past.
Hello, over here. O God, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come, our shelter from the stormy blast, and our eternal home. Disillusioned, let us live ever more deeply into that truth as it becomes ever clearer to us and through us. Amen. God send you, the Spirit fill you, Christ go with you, and you with Christ. always and everywhere. Amen. God bless. Go in peace. Amen.